Now, I've just used two words that may seem to be mutually exclusive, objectivity and expression. Can something be both objective and expressive? Is there such a thing as objective expressivity? Is this aesthetically possible? Well, it not only is, but always has been, and has produced some of the most beautiful music of all history, medieval, baroque, classical, and modern, not the least of which is the music of Igor Stravinsky. Now, at the moment Stravinsky entered the musical scene, this objective expressivity was already in the air. It seemed not only right, but absolutely essential, necessary, because this new attitude of personal disinvolvement was a predictable reaction against the heavy, almost subjective, almost morbid subjectivism that had informed Germanic music from Wagner to Schoenberg. And this reaction flourished centrally in Paris. Paris was now the new locus, and as early as the turn of the century, before even 1898, the startlingly simple voice of Erik Satie could already be heard, utterly dégagé, casually delivering musical objects, purposefully avoiding what was then known as self-expression. No self-expression. A musical object. There's a striking parallel here with the advent of similarly anti-romantic attitudes in Picasso's art of painting, for example, an attitude that also shows up at the same time in writing. Think only of Cocteau. In fact, it was Satie, Picasso, and Cocteau who all collaborated in 1917 on a mad, scandalous ballet called Parade, in which every possible anti-Wagnerian device was exploited to the hilt. And perhaps I should say anti-subjective or anti-romantic device, because I don't want to cast aspersions on the great Richard. Perhaps even anti-bourgeois, not to cast aspersions on the great Karl. And this is what made it seem anti-sincere, especially to the bourgeoisie. Because to many people, Parade seemed frankly anti-art. And it was, in the sense of being opposed to that ponderous, overblown, self-obsessed art of the late 19th century. But in this sense, Parade must be said to be sincere art, no less sincere in its loony way than the ballet music from Aida I was playing before. Like this ragtime from Parade. Perfectly sincere triviality, but sincere. This is mere whimsy, you must understand, compared to what anti-art could be. At its most extreme, it was Dadaism. It was kidding art and kidding the public along with it. Épater les bourgeois, that was the slogan. The score of Parade, for instance, contains such divine musical innovations as the rattle of a typewriter and an amplified puddle, whatever that sounds like. Lots of things like that. And there are a lot of that sort of thing around these days, which makes me think that present-day Dadaists and anti-artniks are probably the most conservative, even reactionary element on the present cultural scene. But our scene does not, alas, contain a Stravinsky in it. Stravinsky was then the genius on the spot, the precisely right man at the right hour, the man who could make aesthetic objectivity work, who could produce beautiful music out of it. Even in such dynamic and emotional works as Petrushka and Le Sacre du Printemps, he keeps a certain distance. The composer is now not expressing himself anymore, his inner conflicts or his psychic geography. He is rather contemplating a world to which he is affectively attached, as Stravinsky was with deep love to the specific world of a Russian carnival, for instance, as in Petrushka, or to the dream world of a pagan Russia, as in Le Sacre, contemplating those worlds and recording musically what they expressed to him. And the resulting music is then a kind of aesthetic document, unromanticized, an objective presentation. You can feel it instantly with the first notes of Petrushka. This is not Stravinsky we are hearing, but an aspect of Russian life, you understand, recorded in Stravinsky's personal language. In other words, it is Stravinsky once removed, objective. And as the music goes on with hurdy-gurdies and calliopes and the ballerina's toy waltz and the trained dancing bear and the puppets dance and all the rest of them, object is added to object and the music becomes correspondingly more and more objectified. Even in the most emotional moments, such as Petrushka's sadness, even here, that sense of objectivity is maintained. It's so touchingly mechanical. You see, the more mechanically and pitilessly Stravinsky presents it, the more moving it is to us. Or take Petrushka's despair. Same thing, objective as a bugle call, but full of despair. And the same is true of Le Sacre, the Rite of Spring, that marvelous opening, comes to us from a great distance. And Stravinsky brings it close to us, but he himself, the ego of Igor, remains at a respectful distance. And that's why the Adornos of this world cannot see him as a sincere artist, because a sincere composer should express his emotions directly, subjectively, like Schubert saying, du bist die Ruhe. That's how Wagner did it, and thus Schoenberg as well. But Stravinsky, can you imagine Stravinsky saying, ich liebe dich, just like that? Out of the question, he was much too much of the great artificer.